You know, I remember someone made that joke in our server where they like posted that GIF of Berserk 2016 where he's like bobbing away like a JPEG where you're moving with your mouse, and I was like, ain't no way that's like that in the anime. Nope. It was like that in Uzumaki. It was Berserk 2016 levels of bad animation.
Yeah.
Like, oh no.
Hello everyone and welcome to Anime Club After Dark, the podcast that delves into all things anime, manga, and otaku culture related. I'm your host, Alex, but you can call me Senpai, and joining me tonight I have our czar of source material, John.
I just noticed that we all have neck beards.
We do?
Alright boys, it's been a good run of the podcast. I think it's time we close it down.
This is like less than 24 hours of growth under here. What are you talking about, a neck beard?
I guess you don't have a neck beard. I have a neck beard.
You definitely do.
I'm an unkempt caveman.
Chinoda is
up to here.
Debatable. Debatable.
Debatable. Okay.
It's reaching there.
But speaking of Chinoda, how dare you spit on his name, sir? The creator of the spiral, you are not. You are not.
I'm pretty sure he doesn't want his name associated with this.
Unfortunately, the three of us have gotten together because we are going to be talking about the anime adaptation of Junji Ito's Uzumaki, which just recently finished airing. I was hoping for a Halloween special this year we would bring better news. Unfortunately, the Junji Ito curse is still in full effect when it comes to anime adaptations of his work. But we are going to be talking about the 2024 anime adaptation of Uzumaki that premiered on Adult Swim here in the U.S. I think it's actually going to be coming to Netflix in Asia at least next month sometime. I don't know exactly when. It's also available, all four episodes are available currently on Max as well to stream if you have that service. I'm not exactly sure where to start. I guess we can start with some of the technical stuff before we get into any kind of plot details. This was a co-production, allegedly, between Studio Akatsuki and Studio Fugaku. Good luck figuring out who did what, because everyone seems to want to fucking disavow that they ever worked on this after episode 2 premiered.
I thought it was Production IG. It's not Production IG?
So, Production IG had a hand in this, but they were not the principal studio involved.
Okay. So supporting.
Because I remember seeing
they
like,
were part of the
said,
production committee.
It said, it didn't say Toonami. What is it? It said Adult Swim.
Adult Swim.
And IG Productions.
Yeah, and it was also partially co-produced by William Street, which is the in-house production arm for Adult Swim.
Okay.
So they work on stuff like Robot Chicken and stuff like that.
That
for
would explain
Adult
a lot.
Swim. Yeah. also, there were a couple of different directors that were credited throughout the run of these four episodes. I believe Yuji Moriyama directed the first episode, and Hiroshi Nagahama, I believe, directed episodes 2 and 3. I don't know who the fuck directed episode 4, because there's no credited director in the credits for episode 4. Like I said, everyone seems to want to fucking disavow that they worked on this shit. which is crazy. Something else I guess to mention about this, and we talked about this during our season preview where we talked about this a little bit, it's been very well publicized that this has been in production hell, at least to some degree, because this was announced back in 2019 at Anime Expo, and it was supposed to come out in 2020. Now, I can forgive its initial delay because some things happened in 2020 that delayed a lot of stuff. So that delay I can kind of understand. All the other stuff, I don't know. There has been so much said, and I don't know who to believe about this. After episode 1 came out, or I should say after episode 2 came out, one of the people who was on the production staff for this, Jason DeMarco, went on to Blue Sky and had like a little thread. This has all been deleted now, by the way. But thank you for the internet archivist out there who preserved this stuff. But I'll just read this as it is. So there it was a thread of three different post that dude put up there. And this was after episode 2 aired and everyone saw the horrendous drop in quality. It's fine. We knew this would happen. I can't talk about what went down, but we were screwed over and the options were A, not finish and air nothing at all and call it a loss. B, just finish and air episode 1 and leave it incomplete. Or C, run all 4, warts and all. Out of respect for the hard work, we chose C. After waiting so long, it makes sense people would be mad. Unfortunately, I can't tell them who to blame it on, .. But someone is definitely at fault here, and we all just had to do our best when things imploded. Maybe others would have made different choices. We did the best we could with what we had. But again, a lot of people worked very hard on this show, and I don't think the actions of just one or two people should be the reason it never saw the light of day. Maybe that's the wrong choice, I truly don't know. But those people have a right to be annoyed and disappointed. I'm glad you are really digging it. I'm assuming that he was responding in this, the last thing he put in, it was a response to someone saying they liked the first episode. So again, this has been deleted. I don't know how true any of this is, but
he did post that. It's true.
He did. This is actually Jason DeMarco. This is his account, and he did actually post this after, and he did delete it within a couple of hours. And this was posted on October 7th, 2024, shortly after the second episode premiered and everyone was losing their shit about how bad the animation quality had dropped. So yeah, I obviously something has gone on behind the scenes in the 5-year plus development cycle for this anime adaptation. We may never truly know what went on, but John was talking to us about it earlier, and I kind of agree with him. I feel like with this sort of admission or thread by Jason DeMarco and seeing what I did see in the 4 episodes, I don't think we can blame this solely on the animators themselves.
No, you can't. Like, there was clearly some skullduggery happening up top, and unfortunately, it happened to roll downhill into everything else, which is quite unfortunate.
I don't know if it's a hot take to say that the animation wasn't the problem with this production of Uzumaki.
It's noticeable, but I don't think it's the biggest issue.
It is noticeable. Like, it's laughable, quite honestly.
In some places, it's very laughable.
Like, you know, the scene where they're running on the beach and it's just like JPEGs.
it's like watching a GIF go.
I will say this. I don't think it's that bad. I think it clearly showed up in a couple scenes here and there.
It has a lot of bad moments.
It has a lot of bad moments. But overall, like big picture wise, I don't think it's that big of a deal.
And
honestly,
if you look at episode 1, clearly there's great animation in episode 1. Like episode 1 looks like, from a technical standpoint, episode 1 looks fantastic.
Yeah.
So obviously there was an ability there that could have been done.
I liked the unique black and white art style.
I did too.
I didn't mind that it was in 3D because, you know, who could tell? It's fucking black and white. You couldn't really tell that it was in 3D.
I love the fact that it was black and white and in 3D because it gave such a unique perspective that I'd never seen before. I was like, wow, this is really odd.
In the first episode in particular, it gave the characters' faces a lot more expression than I think they would have otherwise had.
Well, that's the thing. Like, with a lot of Junji Ito's other works, they tried to... They would color in a bunch of things and just the balance would be off and it just wouldn't look scary. It would just look straight up silly. And I feel like with them deciding to go black and white and 3D, like it's, I believe the other ones were also 3D though. Pretty sure all of them have been 3D thus far. Junji Ito collection and the other one.
Yeah, there is, if they're not like full 3D, they're at least partially 3D.
I'm pretty sure they've all been 3D, but.
Maybe. I'd have to go back and check, but.
I've thrown that out of my mind already. That is the problem here.
The Junji Ito curse, I mean, why would you want to go back?
So, to me, I think the biggest issue with this was the pacing. Like,
yeah, I agree.
When they said it was only going to be 4 episodes, I was like, hopefully they're an hour long.
Yeah, 45-minute to an hour long episode.
Yeah,
that,
if there are 45-minute episodes, then 4 episodes of 40 minutes, that's fine. 160 minutes to tell, you know, essentially what is...
19 chapters, right? Uzumaki is 19 chapters. 20 if you include the bonus one that doesn't really have anything to do with it, but it's 19 total. And they didn't even adapt every single chapter of Uzumaki. They adapted most of them. So if I was like, you know, honestly speaking, if they spent 10 minutes per chapter, 160 minutes, 16 chapters, they cut out just three or condensed it, I would have been fine with that. I really would have. This suffered so much from the setup of, like, first of all, them colliding a bunch of stories together and changing when sequences happen from the start of Uzumaki to the end of Uzumaki. You know, like, they tried to push 4 to 5 different chapters in one episode, and that's just like, what, 4 or 5 minutes per chapter?
If that, there are some chapters that are given only like a single, like 2 or 3 minute scene. I'm like, what the fuck? Like
a single reference to a chapter, and it's
there's an entire half chapter in this manga that's completely omitted, and it's the whole thing with the lighthouse. Like, we get it, we see the lighthouse, we see what it does, but it doesn't show you that it's the lighthouse is what causes the people to run around in circles.
Yeah, you know, it also doesn't...
Let me ask this real quick. Speaking of the manga, has everyone read it? Obviously, Alex has it. He's read it. How about you, John?
Yeah, I've read the manga.
Okay, yeah, so have I. Okay, cool.
Yeah, all of us here, I think... We talked about that during the season preview, I think, that all of us had read the manga at some point.
Yeah. A lot of Junji Ito's works, they're very formulaic in the sense that he has this need to, like, everyday humdrum thing... And then you open a door and something just fucking grotesque or horrifying is behind that door. Like,
Twilight Zones it.
Well, he has said in interviews when he grew up, that's what he would do. He would play this game of like, what if when I was going to the bathroom in the middle of the night, I opened this and this horrendous, horrific monster was just here. And then he decided to turn it into a career.
And the best example of this in Uzumaki is, what if someone took their hat off and that's what you fucking see?
Yeah, like, I would say that specific panel is probably the most well-known panel of Uzumaki. Like, I've seen so many people with shirts with that on it. I'm like, oh, you're a Junji Ito fan, aren't you? And it's like, because it's not disgusting, but it's disturbing as all hell.
It's unsettling, it's uncanny.
Yeah, because it's so... She's supposed to be the most popular, most beautiful girl at the school, and then she takes off her freaking hat, and it's like half her face is missing.
Yeah.
Spirals.
It's like...
You see her eyeball, and it's like, what the fuck, dude?
Who
thinks of this?
The thing with Junji Ito's work, and not necessarily just Uzumaki in particular, but I think a lot of Junji Ito's work, it kind of lends itself more to the uncanny and unnerving than downright horrific.
Yeah, it's always a... How crazy is the panel gonna be when you turn the page or when you get to the next panel?
And how am I gonna pervert something that people think is like everyday or mundane?
Yeah, and you know, for example, my absolute favorite chapter is the mosquito mom chapter.
Yes,
like, because that one's disgusting. It's an absolutely disgusting chapter, and it's like, you think that the horrifying thing was the mosquito moms. Then you think the horrifying thing is that the babies are like, they can talk, and they create this fungus thing out of their umbilical cord, and people are eating this fungus thing. You would think that was the worst of it. The placenta mushrooms. That is not the worst of it in the chapter. The worst of it is when we get to Keiko, and you see the reveal of Keiko all sewed up, and you're just like, what? Like, I couldn't believe
how... And then you hear the baby from the inside, because it was
given birth,
then it was put back in.
Absolutely disgusting. And like, they didn't do that scene justice nearly at all. Like, we can't show it on camera here because YouTube guidelines and stuff like that, but the actual panel in the manga is absolutely horrific. I hate it. It's just disgusting, gives me the heebie-jeebies, and I was like, at least if they don't fuck that up in the anime, then I'll give it a higher score than I did. They absolutely dropped the ball on it. It didn't look nearly as terrifying. It wasn't nearly as visceral of a feeling of like disgust that I had. And I'm just like, the pacing along with just really, it's the pacing. Junji Ito spends a lot of time building up to the reveal, right? In this specific chapter, you think that the bad, terrible thing is that these pregnant women are all getting bit by these mosquitoes, and then all of a sudden they turn into like these zombie vampire women where they're taking hand drills and drilling into patients and sucking their fucking blood and killing them. And they go on this murder spree in the middle of the night and they're pregnant. So they're going to give birth to these babies that are raised on blood. Like, what horrific thing could happen? So you think the horrific thing is the babies, and the babies are pretty horrific. Like I said, they talk. They're talking fully grown, like they have full vocabularies, and
everything
like,
about this chapter is horrific.
Yeah, everything really about it is just terrible, like in a good way, like horrific, terrible, and
like the kind of horror you want.
Yeah, the kind of horror I like and want. You think that the babies with the whole placenta mushroom thing being eaten, people being addicted to those, was the horrifying thing? No, it's not. That's not even half of it.
Yeah,
it's like it keeps going up and up, and you're just like, dude, what the fuck? And it,
which is
that build-up, though, that unexpected scene of, like, when you see Keiko being all sewn up with all the blood and the viscera, that is unsettling.
Yeah.
That was the great highlight to this chapter. And yeah, they didn't do nearly any of that. They didn't spend nearly enough time setting any of this up. So
they yada over a lot of that shit.
Yeah, it kind of just happens, and then it just keeps going. It's like, it happens. Oh, scene's over. Our 5 minutes is up. We're done with the chapter. And it's like,
yeah, we got to move on.
Sucks. Now. That absolutely fucking sucked.
The thing that gets me is, and I think a lot of people might have thought this going into this, that this might have been the best opportunity we ever had to get a good adaptation out of Junji Ito's work. And it's fucked up.
Because
there was a lot of talent behind this. Right. I mean, there was a lot of talent behind this. There seems to, at least with what I saw in the first episode, there seemed to have been a decent amount of money put into this. And like, it's so distressing because there are good things about this adaptation. Like, the music is great. Colin Stetson is the composer for this. And while I don't think he's ever worked on anything, anime related before, he did work on some of the music from the video game Red Dead Redemption 2. He also composed all of the music in the horror, movie Hereditary. Which, that's a pretty good movie.
Love Hereditary. Amazing.
That's a pretty damn good movie. And the music in that, creepy as hell.
No, the music in this was great. I liked it. I had a problem with sound design in certain parts. Like, when the Jack in the Box boy does the spring thing, it's absolutely hilarious
boing,
that they're using,
boing,
like,
boing,
the
boing.
Little, like, the stock boing, boing,
the
boing.
The very Looney Tunes cartoon sound effect that they use.
Yeah, the actual, like, cartoon boing. And it's, like, it's supposed to be a car suspension spring.
Jesus Christ, I can't.
Yeah, a car suspension spring. And it's like, those things are huge and heavy, and they would not sound like boing, boing, boing. All right?
sound more like ka-thunk, ka-thunk, ka-thunk.
Yeah, they're giant, all right? It would be a heavier impact of a sound. And
probably be breaking the concrete a little bit.
Would definitely be breaking the damn concrete. But, you know, that aside, that one instance aside, there was a lot of love to the music, like the ED, right? When you listen to the ED, you hear the singers going in a circle. Like, they're going left to right, like they're in a spiral. And I'm like, that's a cool little detail that I love. I love small little details like that in my horror.
Yeah. Unfortunately, the ED... I watched it on my TV, and I didn't know about it until you told me. Like,
yeah,
that
I had headphones
thing.
On, so the I didn't hear it like going like this. And
yeah, the
like,
only
oh, that's
the
cool.
only way you would have the only way you would have noticed that is if you were either watching on a surround sound television like I were, or like John did with the headphones. But the ED was interesting. Like I can't really say there was anything to say about the visuals because there really weren't any. But the music was really good. The song is Dojoji no Kotoriya, Kotoriyuta. Easy for me to say. By Uki Satake. And it's creepy. It's that thing that John talks about where the balance goes between left and right.
Yeah,
while the song is
like a spiral.
That's great. The series or mini series, whatever you want to call it, didn't have like a proper OP. It just had that piece of music that Colin Stetson composed that plays while the title card goes off. But again, like, there are some things that I can praise about this. The music being primarily like
fantastic.
High on the list. I also, like we talked about, I love the black and white art style. It makes me wish that we could get more black and white anime. Like, I genuinely think there are some anime out there that could benefit from being in black and white.
even though are full color pages of certain chapters for Uzumaki.
Yeah, they're all
black and white.
Now, I will say, I do think it takes a certain experienced director to be able to pull off black and white, but if you can pull it off, man, is it iconic.
Look at the first episode. I mean, the first episode shows that it can be done well.
Yeah, that's absolutely true. But the problem is, they set up like five different... They start like four or five of the chapters in episode one, and they already... already decided from episode one that they would cross a bunch of these episodes or chapters into each other and weave them in and try to kind of create like a chain event, even though it's supposed to be like every chapter happens individually and you just keep progressing towards the time until you get to the end of Uzumaki, which I would have preferred. But like I said, you know, 20 minutes apiece, four episodes, we had 80 minutes to experience 19 chapters. It ain't happening, Chief. The math ain't gonna math.
I guess, to be fair, the last episode is, like, longer.
30
it's
minutes.
It's nearly 30
it's like
minutes.
30 minutes, yes. Yeah. But, point still stands, it because it crossed so many of those stories, it just didn't make sense for a lot of things. Like, Shuichi, the main character, well, rather, we
the
think
one you
he's
think
the
is the main character.
The guy, he's not actually the main character. The main character is his girlfriend, Kirie. She's the entire center of, like, Uzumaki.
In Japanese, he's voiced by Kaiki.
Oh, no way, really?
Yeah, that's Kaiki from the Monogatari series that does his voice shows.
Oh, that's so cool.
Yeah, like, we're missing the detail of Shuichi spiraling, that was not intended, but spiraling into madness as he, you know, we have the first episode where his dad was like, so obsessed with spirals and then he freaking kills himself by turning into a spiral in that bathtub. That was done great. I love that. That was just as creepy as it was
horrifying.
In the manga. That's just horrifying to think about. You open a whole thing and it's just like some dude's twisted himself into a spiral. And it's like, yo, what the fuck?
When the one dude turns into the snail guy for the first time, that's creepy as fuck.
Oh, yeah. When the teacher comes in after he squishes the eggs. Absolutely horrifying. Oh, like grotesque. Grotesque. Great. Great visuals. They did that justice. But the pacing in which they set it, like, we don't get a lot of explanation of why things are being done. You know, that's kind of a problem. It's a major problem when you're trying to explain the story of Uzumaki and you don't get the breathing room to just learn about the history of the town and all these things that slowly link into each other. That's the beautiful part about Uzumaki, the manga.
Yeah.
They
and
like,
completely
skip
out on
that.
It.
Yeah,
yeah, you
completely skip that.
And like, to be fair, the story of the Uzumaki manga doesn't have like a super linear resolution because it's a very Lovecraftian story, and Junji Ito has said as much that he was super inspired by some Lovecraft stories to write this. But in like a typical Lovecraft story fashion, the resolution or the conclusion answers. How, but not why. And that's, you get the same thing in Uzumaki, whether you're talking about the manga or the anime adaptation, that we get that moment at the end. It's like, okay, we know that this machine at the underneath the town, or life form, or whatever it is the one that's causing all this.
Yeah,
but we don't understand. We understand how, but we never,
yeah,
we are never given an answer
why.
As to why.
We don't know why the spiral is alive. We just know that for whatever reason, it has a cycle, and now
it's great for cosmic horror.
It is cosmic horror. It literally is. And it's horrifying.
Which is
exactly
what Uzumaki is. Like, Uzumaki is cosmic horror.
Yeah. No,
100%. I don't know. I wish, because I love this manga. I love, it's one of my, it is one of, if not my favorite horror manga. Depending on how you want to use the term horror. Because there are the things that might not be traditionally considered horror that people might consider horror, like Monster, for example. I love the I love Monster, and I consider that horror, but a lot of people don't.
I mean, I'd say it's psychological thriller closer than it is horror.
And its anime adaptation is great.
Oh, that's a great I love Monster. It's actually really good.
It actually might be, in my opinion, again, I'm using the term horror broadly here. It is the best horror anime out there.
I thought Parasite was all right as a horror manga.
Parasite's pretty good. Yeah.
It's not horror in the fact that like it terrifies you. It's horror in the like the body monster, like the monster, yeah. Horrible monsters, right?
Yeah. But I want to like this more than I do, and I feel like maybe we all feel the same way.
I can't. So here's the thing. I cannot like this more than I like. Like I said, it's got good points, right?
Mm.
But from episode one, I saw the problem, and that was how they were going to do the pacing. Mm-hmm. I can't forgive that. Because when it comes to doing horror, I love horror. I love horror movies.
Yeah, me too.
I love horror video games. Love horror everything. I like getting scared out of my mind.
And I like Junji Ito in particular because he delves a lot into that psychological horror that I love.
I like especially Junji Ito with Uzumaki. Because he just like makes everything creepy. And I'm like, yo, what the fuck? Like, yeah. I don't know what to think after you show me that, Junji Ito. Like, what
and
the
it's
hell,
the
dude?
Biggest, it's the biggest personality dichotomy on the planet because you'd think that someone who makes shit like this would be a grotesque human being. And he's the most wholesome man you'll ever meet.
It's like Miyazaki and Junji Ito had completely swapped bodies and everything.
I know.
But
I
can't like it more than I did because with horror, because I like horror so much, I care a lot about how it's presented. I care about what goes into making good horror, right?
Mm.
It there's an atmosphere and an ambiance that you have to create. You have to immerse the viewer or the reader into it. Junji Ito does that, and you can do that in anime form. A lot of people can immerse people into a story. But for whatever reason, they chose to not immerse us in the story and kind of just go from point A to point B to point C to point D. And we kind of just speed run Uzumaki. Like, the anime adaptation to me is just a speed run of the manga. And
that's exactly terrible. What it feels
Which
like.
Is
that's
the worst way to do it.
Yeah. That is the best way I can think to describe it. It feels like you're speed running a manga.
Like, they're like, we're going to cram as many chapters as we can or as many references to these chapters as we can. And we don't care how much the staff is going to suffer and how much the animation is going to suffer because of that. Like that, that to me, that was the bad decision that someone made.
Yeah.
Where they're like, it needs to have all the chapters. Like, no, it doesn't need to have all the chapters. If it's going to have all the chapters, give me fucking twice as long to do this.
Yeah.
Give me eight episodes or 100. Just somehow get me 180 minutes of this, please.
If they had done like half hour long episodes, like actual like 30-minute episodes, not like 23 minutes or whatever, and had six episodes, I think that could have worked.
Yeah, whatever gets me closer to 180 minutes of actual Uzumaki.
Yeah,
not including credits or opening sequences. 180 unadulterated minutes of this horror manga.
Would've
that
been so
to
much
me
better.
It would yeah, and it's. It's inexcusable to adapt anything horror-related without understanding why it's horrifying.
Why it works.
Junji Ito has a formula. Its formula is slow build-up, creep factor, and then hit you with something that you just don't expect. And then just keep doing that. And you just go, what the fuck? What the fuck, Junji Ito? That's the entire sequence of experiencing a Junji Ito manga. And it's good. I like it.
It's because a great formula. You can say it's you know, it's formulaic, which it is, but it works.
Like, again, I wish I could show the image of Keiko in the manga because it's just disgusting.
I would love to show you, but YouTube-san would not like that at all.
I recommend
look it up.
Anyone
it's horrifying.
Who,
no, I don't even look people it up. Buy this manga.
Yeah,
I
just
get,
go buy
it
Uzumaki. It's good.
The 3-in-1, because this was originally released as a 3-volume manga. The 3-in-1 right now, as at the time of recording this, is $20 on Amazon for a fucking
really
thick-ass hardcover manga. It's great. And it preserves all the great art, and it's even got all the color inserts. I mean, it's great. And it's even got a little thing. It's got a little blurb at the back written by Junji Ito. I mean, it's great. Buy this. If you like horror and you want to see more great horror manga and you've not read this, just buy it. Support Junji Ito.
Like, he needs any more of our money.
Listen, I will headcat that man.
He's been very famous in the horror sphere for a long time, okay? Like, Junji Ito is very well known.
I know, but like, first of all, just read it. It's such a great manga. Read all of Junji Ito's manga. It's great.
Now, I will say, as much as I praise Uzumaki for being a great horror manga, it definitely still doesn't make sense. Like, it's not supposed to make sense.
It does not.
There's you're never going to learn why any of this happens, except you kind of do at the end, but you never understand, like, the reason it happens. You just understand why it happened.
You understand the how, but not the why.
Yeah, it's like, there's a lot of questions that aren't answered. And that's fine. You don't need to answer a bunch of these questions.
Especially for cosmic horror.
I think if Junji Ito had actually tried to explain it any more than it was, it wouldn't be anywhere near as unsettling.
No, like, when it comes to horror, the less that's said, the better, because now you can leave it up to people's imaginations. You know, this is why certain horror things work really well. Like, I'm not sure if you guys remember the Blair Witch video game. If you guys ever watch people play it.
I never played it, but I watch others play it.
The Blair Witch video game I thought was pretty interesting of a video game because it had a story to tell you, but it doesn't tell you everything about, like, why the witch exists and stuff like that, which is what I liked. Like, the entire point of the Blair Witch Project is, you know, not to make a horror movie for $50 with your handy cam, but to...
Which they did.
Which they did. But it was to make an experience where you draw your own conclusions and you make up the story. And that's what I like about the Blair Witch Project in general, us making up our own story. Hell, look at, what's that other one? The one that was inspired by Blair Witch. Paranormal Activity. Yes. Paranormal Activity 1 is actually pretty decent of a horror film in the sense that the less we knew, the better. And then they kept explaining more and more and made more paranormal activities because they wanted to make more money, and it got worse and worse progressively. The more you try to explain to me why the ghosts or the demons are here, the less I care.
This is such a problem too with, like, modern, like, American horror, because, and not even like within the last few years, this has been going on for like 30 plus years now, where a good horror movie will come out, it'll do incredibly well, and now we have to make 50 sequels.
Yeah.
Yet the story is complete in the first fucking movie. This may be a hot take, especially amongst longtime horror fans out there. There never needed to be any more than one Friday the 13th movie. The first one was perfect.
How dare you, sir?
Be so right.
Be so right.
We would have never got Freddy versus Jason thinking.
Freddy vs. Jason is really, really fun, but the great thing about...
It's campy as fuck, and I love it. It's stupid. I know. Yeah. It's not a great horror film. It's campy as fuck. No, but it is funny. But I love it.
It's a funny horror movie.
Yeah, it's a funny
horror comedy is what it is, and it's great.
Yeah.
But no, like, Friday the 13th, the first movie, worked because the twist at the end was so fucking good. And, like, you can't replicate the twist at the end of that movie ever again.
Or, like, why Michael Myers is still even, like, why does Halloween exist? Like, don't get me
wrong.
Exactly. Love John Carpenter. Love Halloween. However. It's just a dude in a fucking mask. Like,
in a William Shatner mask.
He has no superpowers. He's not supposed to be able to, like, withstand bullets.
Yeah.
Like, it's some bullshit. But anyway. I wanted Uzumaki to be done well because
I think we all did.
It seems like the people who did work on it did care about the project, you know, just because of all the small detail stuff. But I understand that when you are producing something, it's not just you as an animator that is calling the shots. You know, you have a whole production team and a whole production council and shit like that that you have to listen to.
Yeah.
I understand that for Uzumaki, a lot of the body horror stuff, it can't be too graphic because it is going to be on TV, which is an unfortunate thing. You know, if this was on like Amazon Prime or like HBO, we probably could have gotten a lot worse.
That's something I feel like could have benefited this as well, being on a streaming service where they weren't like forced to follow FCC guidelines.
Yeah. Because that's one of the things that I was like, ooh, how are they going to adapt some of the more gory things in Uzumaki? As it turns out, they just wouldn't do it. And I'm like, I mean, I saw that coming a mile away. That was one of my major concerns with this adaptation. It's like, ooh, there's certain parts in Uzumaki that are just gross. And I love how gross they are. And I hope they translate that. But how are they going to do it? And they just don't. It's unfortunate.
Yeah.
Like, the part where Shuichi's mom figures out that there's spirals and stuff. Like, when she's in the hospital and she's going crazy, they don't spend nearly enough time building up her insanity. And they cut away from when we see her, like, cutting her fingernails or fingertips off and stuff like that.
Yeah.
They show it, they imply it, you know, that she puts it up there, she starts to slice, you see a little bit of blood, looks away, then you see blood hit the floor, and then you see a bloody finger when you go back. So we know what happened.
Yeah.
But in the manga, you literally just watch her, and it's like, oh god.
It's horrifying.
It's terrible. Don't.
It's like watching, like, someone rip out their own fingernails.
Well, when you have 3 pages of her going psycho mode and being like, I see him in my dreams. I see him everywhere. And it's like, you're going through the psychosis with her. And then you get to the part where she finds the scissors and starts doing it. It's like, that is horrifying.
Or
going through that experience was fucking horrifying.
And then eventually going to the fact that she had spirals in her ears, and then
that's
shoving.
That's what I was going to bring up, because in the manga, that's way more visceral of a scene than we see in the anime. In the anime, they cut away from it entirely when she goes into her ear with it. In the manga, they do not cut away from that.
Yeah.
It's horrific scene.
Yeah, and
that,
like I said,
love.
The buildup of us going through the psychosis with her is what makes this scene so fucking impactful.
Yeah.
It's not just the visual effects and, like, me thinking about if I took some scissors and sliced off my fingertips, that's terrifying in and of itself. But, like, just being there in her head as she's going crazy.
Yeah.
Makes it so good. This makes it such a good scene.
Yeah.
If I may, I do, like, while I do regret the fact that we don't get to see a lot of that, I do like the fact that we do get to see Shuichi descend into madness ever so slowly through the episodes. Like, there was a lot of scene cuts and a lot of skipping that was done, but I did like the progression of his madness, going from slowly normal kid noticing, huh, something's off, to we're all fucked.
I feel like they didn't capture that essence well enough, though. Because, again, in the manga series, every time we meet Shuichi, he gets more and more crazy.
Yeah.
And this adaptation, he's there with us the entire time. And it's like, he's not supposed to be there this entire time. He's supposed to be a recluse going crazy by himself while Kirie, his girlfriend, goes like, oh, I wonder how Shuichi's doing.
See, that's one of the great things about how the story in the manga Uzumaki is told, because when you're first introduced to Shuichi, you're almost expecting him to be like a co-main character with Kirie. Kirie is actually the main character, and it kind of makes you like second guess yourself as an audience member reading this. It's like, am I just watching an unreliable narrator go fucking insane?
Yeah, because
We don't get that in the anime anywhere near as much, because Shuichi's around all the fucking time.
Yeah, and he's just going like, it's the spirals, they're destroying everything. Which is, you know, they represented that properly, because that's exactly what Shuichi does in the manga.
Yeah.
But the thing is, he's not supposed to be there in every single page. We're supposed to be experiencing it from Kirie's eyes, where she's like, she doesn't think there's anything wrong, but we as the audience knows there's something fucking wrong here. But she doesn't know, you know? And that's what makes it even more terrifying, because it's all these random things just happening to her where it's like, whoa, what the fuck?
Yeah. And one of my favorite parts of the manga is the whole thing with the lighthouse. And you realize that it's the thing that's supposed to be making people run around in circles. They completely cut that out of the anime. They mention the lighthouse. They go into the lighthouse and you see how it can kill people.
Yeah.
But they never even touch on the fact that it's the lighthouse that makes people run around in circles.
They don't even mention, the reason why Kirie's younger brother goes there is because he sees his friends, but we don't know that's his friends. We just see a group of kids, and he goes, and then he just runs after them.
Yeah.
That's it.
Although that's completely believable, because it's like little kids getting up to shenanigans together with the complete strangers. I see that
It's
happening.
Believable, but you got to understand as someone watching or reading the story that this dude's doing it for a reason. He's not just doing it to do it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, like, it's bad pacing. It's not good setup. I hate this adaptation.
It needs more runtime, because the pacing is just, it's such a slave to the runtime, and it just didn't have enough time. Like you said, it needed at least 180 minutes of total runtime.
I think that because horror is so hard to balance, right, when you're making a horror anything, horror game, horror experience, you have to balance that type of uncanny feeling that your person who's experiencing it is going to have and the payoffs and stuff like that. Junji Ito does it pretty damn well in all of his horror manga, where he'll pace it out where things are kind of creepy, you kind of can piece things together, and it gets more uncanny until eventually you hit the reveal. You have to have that reveal. Yeah. Or sometimes you don't. Sometimes you don't have that reveal at all, because now you're left with just all this uncanny feeling and no reveal, and now you're absolutely just experiencing dread, because you're like, there was no payoff. I hate this. There was no payoff. Why? Why did this happen? That's another
thing going on.
Yeah. That's sometimes something that you can utilize. So,
which, by the way, is a storytelling mechanic that a lot of analog horror uses.
Yeah. And again, less is more, right? That's the entire point of it.
I feel like Junji Ito should make an analog horror series on YouTube. I bet it'd be fucking amazing.
No, I don't know if Junji Ito makes horror anymore. I like, after his original runs of like Uzumaki, the Junji Ito collections 1-2.
I bet he could do it though. I bet he could still do it.
Oh, he could.
I don't doubt it, but I feel like
one of my like most wanted, we obviously can't do it anymore because one of them is completely retired from filmmaking now. I always wanted to see Junji Ito collaborate with John Carpenter, because that I think that would have been fucking amazing.
I don't know about that, because John Carpenter's style of horror and Junji Ito's style of horror are completely different from each other, in my opinion.
They are, but I don't know. I would have liked to have seen anything that could have come out of that collaboration, because I think it would have been interesting. It might not have been good, but I think it would have been interesting.
I think if you paired him with a different, Kubrick, I feel like Kubrick and Junji Ito could make a really good duo for making a horror film. Yeah.
What about what's the dude now that makes is it Peele? Jordan Peele.
Jordan Peele.
Jordan Peele.
Do you think he could? I think they could probably do something together that'd be pretty good.
I haven't watched too many of his horror films. And
I've heard nothing but positive things.
Whenever I think of Jordan Peele, I think of Key and Peele. So I can't get that out of my head.
Fair enough.
Hey, Aaron! Hey, Aaron!
Fair enough.
Quit playing with me!
While it is good stuff, no.
Hey, people pivot in their careers, John. People do pivot.
No. That's the thing. Like, obviously, if you're a comedian, it doesn't mean you can't be a horror writer. It's just that I've known you as a comedian for about half of my life. So this pivot into horror is kind of like, I'm very skeptical.
People were skeptical of Robin Williams when he got into drama work, but man, that turned out pretty damn good.
Well, it's like, I was skeptical of John Krasinski. He plays Jim in The Office. I was skeptical of A Quiet Place, because I'm like, John Krasinski making a horror film? Like, what the hell? Then I watched A Quiet Place, and I actually like A Quiet Place, like the first
one. I do too.
The second one and the prequel, I haven't seen the prequel yet, but the second one, absolute dog water. Do not watch. But the first one, again, because other than the ending of the first one being like really fucking stupid, I'm like, dude, someone would have figured that out. There's absolutely no way these angels would have not, no one would have figured out that if I hook up a really strange frequency, I could fuck up these things that kill you based on sound. There's no way, unless it happened so quickly, which is why maybe the prequel will explain that away. But point is, you get to the second movie of A Quiet Place, and they just tell you too much, way too much, things that you don't need to know. And it's like, it makes it worse. Again, the less I know, the better. Let me imagine. Exactly. Certain questions that need to be answered, but not all questions, okay?
Yeah. I guess one of the last things I want to ask both of you. So does this actual adaptation of Uzumaki change the opinion that I think a lot of us have had about horror being successfully translated into anime? Because I think a lot of our opinions have been like, it seems very, very difficult to do it in an anime style well.
I think it's difficult to do horror in anime, mainly because it takes a lot of love for the source material. Because, again, Japanese...
And pacing.
And pacing, sound design, how it looks and stuff like that. Because there's Japanese ghost movies, horror movies, that I absolutely adore. I think that One Missed Call, Black Ghost, White Ghost, The Grudge,
The Ring,
The Ring. Not really The Ring. The Ring is kind of dumb, but all these, there's Japanese horror movies that I love. There's Japanese horror games I absolutely love. You know, yeah. Fatal Frame is creepy as all hell. I love Fatal Frame. But Silent Hill? Holy shit, Silent Hill is great.
I was just about to say Silent Hill.
Terrible movie franchise, but that's more psychological than it is, like, physical body horror. Though it definitely has body horror with the fucking nurses and shit like that. Oh, yeah. God. But point is, horror can be done in so many ways by the Japanese people, but for whatever reason, in anime form, it just seems to never work, even though we have novels, graphic novels, fucking manga, video games, movies, live-action movies, dramas, TV shows. We have every single form of it that's done pretty well in its own right. Then you have anime, and it's like, what's the difference? There shouldn't be a difference.
The one caveat I will say with anime is it does comedy horror well. Like Zom 100, great.
Well, that's a whole different thing, though.
But it is still horror. It's just a different type of horror.
I don't know if it's a budget thing or something like that. Maybe because with animation studios, the budget is a lot different compared to like a live action or anything like that, or a movie.
Or even a video game.
But there are decent horror anime. Like we talked about Monster. I know Parasite is another one I liked. I'm not sure if you would count Blood Sea and Blood Plus and stuff like that.
Horror adjacent at the very least.
I mean, it's gore.
Yeah, but gore itself isn't necessarily horror, because like war movies have gore in them and they're not horror.
Don't say that to the people who are fans of Nightmare on Elm Street.
Yeah.
That's just a gore fest. It's not actually scary, it's just gory.
It's like the old Grindhouse double features.
There is my hot take of the season here for you horror fans out there. I don't think Nightmare on Elm Street is that great, because it's literally just buckets of blood, the movie.
Yeah. It's creative uses of gore sometimes, but...
Listen, I think Final Destination... If you want, like, buckets of gore horror...
Final Destination?
Final Destination's got to beat by a mile.
Yeah.
Tell me another movie franchise that has traumatized an entire generation of children to be afraid of driving behind log trucks. Because to this day, I am terrified of driving behind a log truck. Whenever I'm behind one, I gotta move. I gotta go to the next lane. I can't.
I gotta get off the interstate, man. I gotta get off right now. I think the Final Destination stuff works because it's like you're fighting against inevitability.
Because
fighting against the concept of death.
Final Destination is just, man, I wonder how messed up their death is going to be because they avoided their first messed up death. And then you just look for stuff and you're like, oh, what's it going to be that kills them? That's the joy of Final Destination.
Some of those deaths are a little contrived, I will admit.
A lot of the deaths are really fucking stupid. But, that's the point of Final Destination. It's the gore horror.
Exactly. Yeah.
Which is like, to me, I think it's a valid form of horror. It's just all gore. Because, again, Nightmare on Elm Street has a lot of fans. Final Destination has a lot of fans. People liked Another. That's a gore anime.
It's like
gore
Another,
horror
yeah.
anime.
Right. Yeah, but I guess to finish this off, the unfortunate part, our scores that we give this out of 10. I'm going to be a little bit of an outlier here. I give this a 5 out of 10. I think it's actually worse than the two scores you guys gave it, because it is the mid score. The one thing I will say that kind of saves it and keeps it from being like a 3 or a 4 for me is... there are some things I like about it. The first episode was genuinely well animated and well done, I think. The music is actually genuinely good and creepy. Colin Stetson, I think, did a really great job with at least the atmosphere of the music in this. And I do like the ED, the song that is in the ED a lot. It is kind of creepy and shit. Other than that, I can't find a lot of redeeming things in here, especially with how bad the animation gets past episode 1 and what we talked about with the pacing. It's just, it's kind of unforgivable.
Yeah.
So, for me, 5 out of 10.
For me, I've got to give Uzumaki a 4 out of 10 because it was worse than mid, which is kind of a better thing, I guess, because I can remember, oh god, remember Uzumaki? That was a bad adaptation. But The reason I have to give it a 4 out of 10 is because every single time I'd watch a certain scene from Uzumaki, I'd be like, man, I can't believe they cut that out. Man, I can't believe they changed that from the manga. Like, it was just constant. I couldn't stop thinking about how... I couldn't stop comparing it to the manga and how it was better in the manga. It was done better in the manga. It was done better than in the manga. If that is my entire experience watching it, it is not a good adaptation. And yeah. I have maybe 3 or 5 positive things to say about Uzumaki, the animation, which was, you know, episode 1's animation was pretty decent. Again, the music, phenomenal. Black and white style, great. I'm trying to think of the other two. It's hard. It's really hard.
The use
hard.
Of 3D
oh, yeah,
was actually 3D pretty effects, decent.
Yeah. And they built up the reveals pretty well. I would say that's one thing that it is a positive. The reveals for certain things were done pretty well. Specifically just the dad in the tub thing in episode... Was that that was in episode 1, right?
That was in episode 1, yeah.
The less gory things I thought were done and executed well because it was all about like the body disfiguration and stuff, which isn't gory, so it won't be too censored. But the rest of the gory stuff, because they had to censor it, it was just not great. Which, again... That's not really the fault of the animation studio. That's because it's on TV. So yeah, I can't really knock it for that, but they tried.
Would have benefited from being on a streaming service exclusively, I think.
I think it would have benefited quite a lot if HBO picked it up instead.
Yep.
All right. Yeah. Speaking of HBO, these two actually watched it live. Alex watched it on TV.
I watched it on Adult Swim as it was premiering, yep.
And John watched it on the Adult Swim website.
Yep.
I
have TV. I still have cable. I'm one of those people who still have cable.
One of those.
Yeah. Who has cable these days? Me.
Alex.
Yeah, see? There are dozens of us. Dozens.
The two oldest people on the podcast.
Seriously.
I unfortunately watched it on Max, and there were subtitles issues for me watching the Japanese sub. It was a matter of, like, they were saying things, and, like, whatever they were saying didn't appear, and, like, some of the old dialogue was still there when it shouldn't have been. It was really weird, really off-putting issue that completely took me out of the anime, unfortunately. I hated it, and I know that's not the fault of the anime itself, but still, it definitely took me out of my experience. So take that as a warning from me. Maybe watch it somewhere else, check to see if it's working. I heard from Alex that the dub is perfectly fine, so maybe watch that instead, unfortunately.
That is something we didn't hit on. The dub is actually halfway decent.
Yeah. So... That's a technical issue that happened for me. My score was 4 out of 10 as well. Reiterating a lot of points John said, but what he said didn't matter as much to me as much as there were just weird animation frames that didn't last too long, but it was still
the
noticeable.
Punch. The yeah, punch the from punches. 10 million miles away. The fucking JPEG running. It's so bad. They like didn't even properly like put drop shadows on it. They just had a black fucking rectangle following them. Like, what is this?
The odd sound effects.
The fact that there are certain scenes in this where the lip flaps don't match up to either Japanese or English.
God, that was so bad.
Yeah, there was bad sound design in certain parts. Just bad.
So, unfortunately, a lot of things like that just really take you out of the anime. And for that reason, I just have to knock it down so many points. I wish it wasn't like that, but it is. So, 5, 4, 4. It's not passing.
it's certainly not good. By any stretch, unfortunately.
Go read the manga.
Because, yeah, like I said, go read the manga.
Just go read Uzumaki. Just do it.
John, can I interest you in some placenta mushrooms?
God. Oh. It's like, it's the best chapter,
but it's the worst.
It makes you feel the worst, but it is the best chapter.
It's the best one, in my opinion. It's the one that makes me go, like, for Heart example, voice. Like, I absolutely, what? There's one horror video game I absolutely hate. Like, I hate playing it because it's that.
It's not Dead Space, is it?
No, I love playing Dead Space. I absolutely hate Outlast. Outlast is terrifying to play. I hate how helpless the game makes you feel, which means it's a great fucking horror video game because you're so defenseless while you play Outlast.
And it's also full of jump scares.
Full of freaking nudity and horror and blood and gore. It's just terrifying. Absolutely hate playing Outlast. I bought Outlast when it came out, played it for about an hour, and absolutely said, nope, I can't handle this. I'm returning this. Please give me back my money. This game absolutely terrifies the shit out of me. That's how you know it's good, because it's that immersive that I'm like, nope, uh-oh, I can't touch it.
I don't even want to own it.
Fair enough. Fair enough.
Let me ask you guys this. What better horror anime would you recommend?
Monster.
Monster?
I mean, Monster's absolutely
Monster's
great.
A phenomenal anime and a phenomenal manga.
Right, it's, John? It's just phenomenal in general, yeah. Put me on the spot here, bro. Like, I don't know too many horror anime that are actually good to be recommended. I thought Parasite was good. Parasite was a good adaptation. Parasite. Great music. Yeah. Great animation. I think it was done by Madhouse, right?
Yes, the anime was done by Madhouse, I believe. Yes.
And
I'll double check that, but I think you're right.
Yeah. And as for me, I would recommend it's much slower in comparison. It's called Hell Girl. Now, this series goes back to, I want to say, early 2000s, possibly. It's been around for a while. And it's even had a season as late as, like, 2 years ago, I want to say, at this point. Either 2 years ago or last year.
There's another anime I've talked about that I said it's like Junji Ito, where it's got like horrifying ghost monsters. It's Maruko-chan something.
Oh,
I heard about this. Yes.
It's that cutesy looking one.
That's a lewd one.
Yeah, it's a little bit. The anime is a lot more lewd than the manga. It's a little bit more lewd than the manga. It's a lot more lewd than the manga. I like the manga, but it's terrifying. Like, absolutely. Like, God, these grotesque monsters.
And actual jump scares that'll, like, give you the heebie-jeebs and straight up, like, whoa!
Yeah, it made me punch my fucking monitor.
But is it a punch from far away, John?
No. 10-mile punch.
No. That's actually scary.
Yeah. I still say one of the best horror anime out there, especially if you're looking for a good psychological horror, is Monster. It's unmatched. And it is, I did look it up, it is done by Madhouse.
Okay.
And it is a lovely 74 episodes.
Oh, wow.
Maybe the real horror was the murdering of our hopes and dreams.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, man. That is, unfortunately, our review of Uzumaki. I hope that it was better. I'm sure a lot of people hope that it was better, but unfortunately, that is what we got. But that is the true horror of Junji Ito's work, is it? Like Berserk, we will never see a good anime adaptation of it.
You know, I remember someone made that joke in our server where they, like, posted that GIF of Berserk 2016 where he's, like, bobbing away like a JPEG where you're moving with your mouse. And I was like, ain't no way that's like that in the anime. Nope. It was like that in Uzumaki. It was Berserk 2016 levels of bad animation.
Yeah.
Like, oh, no.
All right. Well, thank you all out there for dropping in to watch us. Don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, all that good stuff if you like what you saw and want to see more. Let us know what you thought of Uzumaki, if you thought it was as bad as we thought it was, or maybe you think we're overreacting. Let us know. If you liked it, please let us know what you loved about it. Also, check down below where you can find links to Anime Club After Dark, everywhere we post stuff. We also have a link to our merch store down there where you can buy Anime Club After Dark merch if you want to support us that way. With that being said, I have been your host, Alex, and we will see you next time. Say goodnight, guys!
Good night.
Happy Halloween!
Happy Halloween. You spin me right round, baby, right round, like a disco round.
What?
Shinoda, I spirals, showed you my round. Spiral. Oh. Answer me.
I hate everything.